On boats in the late 50s, there were lots of oddballs. It was traditionally an oddball thing, you know. There were lots of artists and writers and such like. And of course, it was easy to do because there were so many craft available. You know, ships' lifeboats after the war, because the Thames barge trade was really at its end, there were huge numbers of old wooden barges available, which made lovely homes.
So the mooring that I grew up on in Chiswick was established after the war by the church in order to create homes for returning service men and women after the war and create low-cost housing.
They would have been old wharves and quays long before all this stuff was here. You know, it was a working river. They were still cement barges coming in just at the top of Hollow's Put. The Dutch trading boats still came up here to Isleworth. It was still a working river.
The river had a sort of glorious Indian summer, I think, in the 1960s, when in fact it was still quite busy, even as far upstream as this. But with containerization, the commercial life of the river basically moved downstream. So moorings like this ceased to have a kind of much of a use as commercial moorings.
Traffic on this bit of the river, commercial traffic, cargo carrying traffic, actually stopped whilst we were living here. And that must have been the end of something that had been going on, you know, literally for thousands of years.
For some people it's the dream that they really want to go to Holland, find that boat, bring it over, build it up, you know, that kind of thing. Or you'd get the real boaty types who genuinely take their boats out, go off sailing around France or wherever, and they are the proper nautical types. Or you've got the people that, yeah, have that affordability, that London accommodation affordability problem, so they might choose a boat as a cheaper option. So, yeah, proper mix of why people do it.
You know, there are people along the river who just have it in their blood, and they absolutely cherish every moment and fight for it. And especially the people with engines, who are fiddling around with engines, or the incredibly practical people who... It sort of nourishes the vagabond or the gypsy soul in them.
All sorts of people, really. But it is very white and very middle class, I would say. Generally.
It appeals to people who are practical, you know. It's a way of being marginal. It's a way of being in the mainstream, but not of the mainstream.
I left school when I was 16 and immediately kind of ran away, effectively, not quite ran away to the sea. I sort of fetched up on the river. And I think I met Tam on Eel Pie Island. So I met Tam when I was about 16. And he was living on a boat up at Isleworth, Chris Cruisers.
I lived on the boat from the age of about 3. But there wasn't. It wasn't done up as a boat. I mean, it was a boat, but you climbed down a ladder, and it was just there was just sawdust, and you know there were no divisions. Everything was knocked out, and I don't even know if there was a floor actually. I think it was the bilges and some things over the bilges.
Well, my background is as a journalist, and I came to Live Afloat because I loved the idea of living on a boat. So I was a student, and. Wandered around looking to see if there was a boat that I could purchase or rent, and found a boat here called Stella Maris. That was the late 60s.
I think it was 72 we came here to the big space next door. And somebody I was working with said, I think the woman who owns this boat, Leonard Piper, she's looking to move. She might want to sell it, you know. And we came to look at it and we thought, well, you know, nobody else knows this is for sale. So we made an offer and so we bought it.
I was going to art college in London. I'd always wanted to live on a boat. I think, personally, when we bought the boat, it was quite nice to find a crack in the pavement and you could become a member of the underclass quite comfortably and we could disappear.
In desperation. It was the houseboats column of a magazine called Exchange and Mart. And there we found this boat. And we were literally homeless, you know. There we were. We were camped out in my mother's house, all of us in one room. And we came down and had a look at it. Couldn't believe it was the middle of London, because you just turn off the A4, the Hogarth roundabout, and you come down this lovely little old lane with 15th century. Buildings in it, low there's the river, and then you come down and you get to the bottom here and we'll have it.
I moved into this house and Mike Thomas was looking at boats but didn't really want to, hadn't got the money to buy one on his own or whatever, and I thought that was a really stupid idea. I mean, living on a boat, you know. And then Mike took me to visit this rotting Thames sailing barge down the estuary, and I thought, that's it, I don't want to live in a house, I want to live on a boat.
An old friend of mine from university saw a boat to rent and he said, why don't you come and live on a boat? And I said, well, you can't live on a boat. And he said, well, you can. So I said, well, if we sink, it's your fault. And so we went and lived on this boat, and it was terrible, it was awful. It was cold and it was wet and it froze, and we ran out of heating and water, froze up and everything. And we lived on it for a year. And at the end of the year, we knew that we couldn't stay on that boat any longer because it was so horrible. But we discovered that we loved the community and the place, and we'd had some great parties. And we thought, well, if you've got to live in London, and this is probably about the nicest bit to be.
Now, I'd lived on sailing ships for many years, and then I had also lived in a showman's wagon for 5 years when I was farming in Cornwall. And So a sort of showman's wagon to a houseboat, it's not a very big move, actually. It's very similar.
This is described as a gentleman's yacht, twin screw diesel yacht. It's 30 metres long and was built in 1916, so it's 100 years old.
It was a Thames sailing barge, Leonard Piper, built in 1910 at East Greenwich.
Cetus was a Dutch sailing barge, a wooden 100 foot, 23 foot wide or 21 foot wide, beautiful. Beautiful old boat, big kind of whale of a boat with a really ugly deckhouse that we put on because we didn't have any money. It really did look like a shed. Well, it didn't even look as good as a shed. It was really crummy.
We lived on Reliance, which is a Humber motor barge. She was built in 1933 for a coal merchant in New York. And she carried coal from the Yorkshire collieries down to York for most of her working life. So she had quite a hard life.
I used to tell the story that she was an ice cream boat on the River Rhine, but apparently that was not true at all. So yeah, she was just a trade boat on the River Rhine. And I mean, she's had many different owners. She's been built up. She's a proper hotchpotch.
I have a classic Luxemotor, and it's from 1927. Well, she's quite sexy for a start. She's got a fabulous aft curve under her stern. I mean, you recognize a Luxemotor because it has this sleek cut underneath. And then just the wooden wheelhouse. It's the little window seems so perfect. It's almost as if it's a little person, but it's not.
I lived on a trawler, which is at Chiswick Pier, called Victory, which is a 72-foot North Sea fishing boat. Because, you know, I wanted to do something a little bit different from, you know, the run-of-the-mill Dutch barges and stuff. So a decommissioned fishing trawler was the obvious choice, wasn't it? Barely get under Hammersmith Bridge. And because of that, because it was so tall, it was, you know, the opportunity to go out and enjoy the river again evaporated. Bad decision. But it looks pretty.
Before, it was just a derelict hull. It was just up to here, and it was just full of weeds and rubbish, and no cabin at all, no engine. It was just a bit of riveted steelwork with a wooden bottom, which was elm planks, which was had to be repaired, and I ended up replacing it with steel.
This was a cargo boat, so everything you see here was empty. It was just space with canvas over the top. And all of this is new. You know, the upstand at the sides and the windows and the steel deck over it and the hatches and things, everything is new. And I got to know it very well when it was being converted because I'd come along every single day to look at it, to the boatyard, and we'd discuss everything. And I said, if you have any questions, ask me. Don't just do what you think might be okay because I want every detail to be completely perfect. And it's worked out very well.
I cut off all the top superstructure and built the new structure that went right to the outside to give us the biggest accommodation possible. But it still looked like a boat. It still had ship's windows in it and stuff. It wasn't a box.
Because this is such a museum piece, we've been trying to essentially restore it back to the original. And really quite irritating, I suppose, because we have all the original drawings, we know what it's supposed to be like.
And this was built with all mod cons in 1916, so it had central heating, it had electric light, it had telephones, it had lots of things that most houses didn't have in those days.
Living on the Leonard Piper, as I've said to one or two people, is like living inside a cello or living inside a double bass. The decks had sort of meter-long steel rods drilled through from the side, holding it all together, pins all over the place. So the amount of work was, you know, was a delight. It was a delight. I mean, I like wood. A piece of nice wood really turns me on.
But to be in a boat that's made of wood, that's got wooden beams that are curved with just shafts of light that are dancing on the floor, that's just an exceptional thing, and a little bit like being the body of a whale.
And then we were very lucky with the location here in Chiswick, because across the river there's a disused reservoir, so it's very beautiful. So you get a lot of wildlife and so on. So we were living in London, but it was almost quite rural. You know, you could imagine you were in the middle of the countryside if it wasn't for the Concorde going over and things like that.
I mean, these moorings, like some other moorings, I'm sure, they have something unique, which is that they're in the heart of London, but you feel that you are within a tiny little world within London. It's very strange that you close the gate behind you and you walk out in the evening to your boat and you forget about the city. But it's still all around you.
The joy of the routine is the river. The river, the tide, the kind of sense of this excitement as the tide comes in and builds. And especially when it's a big tide and it's going to flow, cover the island and everything floods. And you just rise on the top of it. It's fantastic. And it's beautiful. And the water's full and everywhere. And then there's this sort of slightly sad moment when the tide turns and you think, there, that was great, wasn't it? And then you know that it's then going out and you see this line growing bigger on the side of the shore and the tide's going down now. And then the tide goes back down to the mud and the boat's sitting on the mud again. And it's a very beautiful cycle.
I used to sleep below the tide level, below the water level. And the tide's going up and down is in my heartbeat, it's in my blood. It's sort of having an ever-changing view outside the window is in my blood.
The view, that's the one thing you always have on a boat. You can see into the distance, you can see the water, you can see changing weather. And if you've got a boat that moves, you can change your view when you feel like it.
There's all this sky as well, you see. Sky? I know everybody has this bloody sky, but this is a sky of a particular scale. And
I love the light through the windows because it sort of dances, you know, it looks like sort of Tinkerbell or something, you know, fairy light, this incredible dancing light that comes off the river.
I think probably standing at the sink, I enjoy looking out the window there when I'm washing up or when I'm just standing there. There's something very beautiful about that, especially when you get a geese or swans come to the window, or, you know, it's just, they figured out that sometimes you'll throw bread out. So sometimes sometimes we'll get swans come to that window there, or they'll look at where you are, and then you'll hear this kind of, and there's this great big swan, I mean big, you know, and he's like, come on in, I'm hungry, what's going on, well, you know, and it's so beautiful because, and I mean, it's, you shouldn't really be feeding them so much, but when they beg like that, it's pretty difficult not to give them half a loaf of expensive Waitrose bread.
I mean, poor old David slept on a shelf till he was 12. And then we robbed a bit of the engine room and made the back cabin. And he came home from school one day. He said, I've been doing French, Mum. And we had to describe your bedroom in French. And I had to ask the teacher what a shelf was. And then he said, I had to ask her what a wheelhouse was in French. And then she got really cross with me and said how stupid it was to live on a boat. So we decided that it was time to build him a cabin. But
a lot of my friends lived on boats. So like Leonard Piper, my best friend Edmund, lived on Leonard Piper. He'd just jump off the boat, float down, knock on the porthole. And he was a real, you know, he is a real boat liver.
And he had his own dinghy, so in the morning he'd just get out and, you know, when he was about 10 or 11, in his life jacket with his dressing gown and things and pistols and various things, and, you know, with his own outboard engine and bomb up and down the Thames.
The thing I liked most was really being able to jump in a canoe and go paddling off the end of your boat. We would paddle off after the riverboats and get onto the wake behind the riverboats, you know, and surf along on the riverboat's wake. You know, it's fantastic.
And we used to just jump off the edge in life jackets and float down Hammersmith and get out down at the steps there. And, you know, I mean, it was like a really fun life.
Because it was a wharf, there was lots of wood. So the children used to make their own camps and swords. So outside of our boats, we had about, I don't know, 50 different swords. It looked like we were some sort of religious sect because they were crosses, but they were swords. So it was a very sort of free, it was almost like a commune.
We used to go off the barge when the tide was coming up, swim across to the Isleworth Eight, which is the island between the Hollis footpath and Kew Gardens, built, I think, by Queen Victoria, so she couldn't see the gasworks in Brentford. And then you'd walk down the island and go back in the water so that you'd be swimming back up to the barge with the tide. So that was quite nice.
And I love swimming, so I used to, in those days before the Thames Barrier, the garden flooded a lot. So you could basically walk across the gangplank and just jump into the garden, which was flat, and swim across the grass, across the lawn, across the roses and everything, in amongst the sort of dead cats and, you know, things. So I love swimming. And you could swim out of the garden and down the road, past the cars and past the lampposts and the pillar boxes and everything. And I had, like, rafts, and we had sailing, but we had mini sails and canoes. So it was very tomboyish-like, very Huckleberry Finn life.
Certainly, you had fog that was so thick you could not actually see your hand. That was the limit. You couldn't see anything at all. And I can remember coming back from Richmond one day, back to the boat at Isleworth, the 2744, and having to get down on my hands and knees and crawl along the towpath because you couldn't see where the towpath ended and where the slope into the river was.
When we first moved onto the boats, we had a water tank on the roof, which froze in winter. So if it froze a lot, you didn't have any water. And when we first moved onto the boat, we didn't have a bath or anything. So I used to go around friends' houses with a bottle of wine in one hand and a towel in the other, saying, "Can I have a bath, please?"
With the tide, you do get some problems. Because everything has to flex, our gangway, our services. So we do get some problems with service disconnection. In fact, we currently don't have a telephone line or internet because our cable is broken somewhere.
There was one classic about 2 years ago. There was a very strong storm that everyone knew about, and I heard about it. A few of our friends were away, so I ran up and down the towpath, tying everyone's furniture down, putting extra ropes on boats and all the rest of it. And then Louise and I stood here when it arrived, and it arrived with a real bang. And the only damage was our patio table shot up in the air and disappeared over the side of the boat. And Louise went, "You tied them all down, didn't you, apart from ours?" I went, yeah, I forgot ours. So, but we got it back when the tide went out, there it was down there, so. No loss.
When I was growing up, I think seven people were caught in our anchor chains, and, you know, the police would come and take them over our boat. I think our anchor chains stuck out a long way. A lot of people used to, sadly, jump off bridges, and we just happened to have a chain that went across the river on a side of an island where they tended to get, when they were sadly lower down in the water, they'd get caught in our chain. So in the morning when my mum opened the porthole, quite often she'd see somebody there.
I must say, I have to confess, I haven't confessed that to all my friends here, all my neighbours, but I did fall in once. There was a large sort of chunk of wood that was banging against the hull and stuck between my boat and the next door boat. So I got quite cross about this, so I took my broom, my sort of deck brush, and popped onto my neighbour's lower deck and pushed it. And of course, when you push something, it goes away, doesn't it? And you're leaning out. And so I did a sort of slow motion, wonderful plop into the water. The first thing I thought was quite warm, actually. The first thing I thought was, oh my goodness, I hope nobody's seen me. I feel such an idiot. So I took about a couple of strokes and then climbed up onto my boat with the fenders, you know, thinking, how crazy, you know. So these things can happen.
Had very primitive systems, and we had very little hot water, And we had electrics where when you touch the electrics, you know, they spark. All that stopped being quite so funny when we had friends coming over and they didn't find that very funny.
Well, I always say don't live on a boat unless you like glamping or camping, because you do need to deal with the fact that your gas is going to go or the water's going to stop.
I mean, the loo was pretty memorable because it was horrific. It only worked when the tide was up. When the tide was down, it couldn't quite get anything up the pipe and it would all come straight down again and come out the loo.
Well, when I first came here, you'd think you could walk across on the outgoing tide. You'd think you could walk across on the rubbish. If you fell in, which I did, you had to have a stomach pump. The river was so polluted. There was nothing alive out there.
Yes, I sadly lost one of my children to the river. He drowned in 1992. So the challenges are there. That was it, Chiswick. So he was 4 and a half. That was very tough. He went to play with some neighbours' kids. And then he was sent off home alone and he didn't get there. So that was tough.
It's late, I'm tired, I don't wanna go home tonight, so I'll stay for a while. I lay my head down on the table, you come and sit next to me. Are you the one to take me from this place? I don't belong. Who do you love when the sun's coming up and the moon still hanging around? Who do you love when the sun's coming up and the moon still hanging around?
I went on a million sailing courses as a child at Falmouth. I'm terrible at sailing. I don't get it at all. I don't get how you come in if the tide's going one way and the wind's blowing you that, how you ever get back. And so it's not important to me at all. No, I'm very stationary. I think it's lovely if you are someone who can fiddle around with an engine and then, you know, steer and great. That's not me at all. And I've never had a boat that you could do that with.
So I've never been a sailor. And indeed not spent much time on the river. In the river, you see, I've spent a lot of time in the river when the tide's out, and know that aspect of it very well, but not coming and going.
Most boats here don't go out, so I have a boat because I like travelling, and so the idea of just sitting here all the time, that was never my plan, and I've always tried to keep the boat in a state of readiness to go anywhere, anytime. So within 5 or 10 minutes, I could be off.
You know, you could go cruising. I remember the first time we went cruising, and I was going off on holiday. I thought, oh bugger, I should have remembered to bring. And then you suddenly realise that you didn't have to remember to bring everything. It was all there with you. You were taking you home.
And yes, I did mention knocking down the wheelhouse. And that was a lot worse than knocking a hole in the boat. It was the very last trip we did on Reliance, and it was very early in the morning and I was a bit sleepy, and it was a very difficult bridge way up river, and it was one that even the trip boats had problems with. And I caught the wheelhouse and the whole thing collapsed. It was very, very scary. So we were suddenly on this happy holiday, and then suddenly we were on this boat, and it was like, you know, a snail without its shell, you know, it was kind of open to the world. So anyway, we managed to kind of lean on family and friends, and we got it back up again. But I think everybody has to have one or two accidents on a boat to be able to boast about. It does actually, living on a boat does, as you've probably noticed, supply you with an endless stream of boring anecdotes.
There's houseboats and houseboats on the River Thames. There's houseboats who people look after them, spend a lot of money on them, spend a lot of time on them, and they're beautiful. But you do go to some places and you find gear, how they stay afloat, I don't know.
Old wooden barges fill up with water. Slowly but surely, they leak a bit. The planks shrink and they take in water. And every so often on the barges here, they would have a bung in the bottom of the boat. So when the tide went out and you were sat on the hard, if you pulled the bung out at the bottom of the boat, all the water in the bilges would all slowly drain away.
And whenever we went away, my parents were very worried that she'd sink or water would come in, because we had a lot of bilges, bilge pumps, and we had a lot of leaks. And she kept sitting on things that went underneath her, the boat, and then water would come in to the bilges, and the bilge pumps couldn't possibly sustain the amount of pumping they needed to get rid of the water, and the water would come up through the floor. And, you know, I remember my dad used to be wandering around in sort of large waders, taking us out of bed and taking us upstairs to get us out.
There was 30 years of maintenance here. I maintained this boat. It wasn't insurable. So if you were proactive, well, it was insured for fire, but it wasn't insurable as a hull, then, and it would have been dangerous to take it out. Because it wasn't so much fragile, it was just there was nowhere to put it. A boat that big to repair it on the Thames, there was nowhere to do it. And it hadn't occurred to us when we bought it that all this might matter. You know. But I think that's often the case with people buying boats. You don't necessarily look that far ahead. You know.
Living on a houseboat is a perpetual process of conversion. So you're always turning your houseboat. There's always about 15 million jobs to do, because you have the joy of being able to have a place you can amend and adjust. It does not subject to the same boring building regulations that make all the houses look the same.
I mean, certainly at weekends, we spent a lot of time working on the boat. You know, Sue Gurney across the pontoon on Radiant, and I used to be in our boiler suits, and we used to wire brush, and you used to get covered in grit. Worst bogies in the world from wire brushing. And you'd see all the people walking along the riverside path with nice prams and all clean, and we'd be going, what are we doing, Sue, you know? But we loved it, really.
And our sort of beauty thing was Swarfiga and washing up liquid. And when it was a bad day, we said it was swigging Sainsbury's sherry, which turned us into alcoholics because it was cheap. It was just what we needed, yes. And we'd always be just in boiler suits or headscarves and looking dirty from angle grinding and whatever. So that was us, and we thought we'd look beautiful if we washed, yes.
But as we got older, it got more nerve-wracking for my parents because the boat got grottier. And then she really let it, you know, it sank. And then we still went on living on her, which she was sort of patched up. And she smelt quite bad, and there was, you know, we had the bilges, so there was mud everywhere, and there were mud marks on the walls, and even the floorboards, how much cleaner, you could see where the water would periodically come in, and everything smelt damp, and all our clothes were mildewed, and then it was less fun, I suppose. I mean, I still kind of loved it, but it was less fun.
Another sort of abiding memory was when we first moved on to Reliance, and this boat was just covered in rust, so I got very adept at a chipping hammer. And so I was down in the hole chipping away at this rust below the waterline. And I'd said to somebody, what happens if I knock a hole in the boat? And they said, no, you won't do that. Anyway, I did.
And there was this sort of stream of water coming in, and I put my thumb over it, you know, like the little boy with the dam, going, oh my God, I've sunk Reliance. I mean, we'd only had the boat about 3 months, so I rang Mike at work and he couldn't come home or anything. Anyway, the guy next door said, just put a rag over it and a brick, it'll be all right. So anyway, that night I got down with a fan heater outside the boat, in the mud, managed to dry it off. And by this time I'd got quite good at fiberglassing and fiberglassed all on the outside and the inside. And I think it was the strongest bit of Reliance for many years. So.
The key element of later life there is that the boat flooded after we'd been here 40 years and we had an incident of a flooding. Fortunately, it wasn't a very high tide. We still had a metre of water inside, which removed about 30% of our possessions. Killed, you know. Well, we left because time was up on this old boat of ours. She was 103 years old. It was always clear that there was going to be some limit, which is true for all boats. I mean, it's true for this one as well, probably, but it's steel. A timber boat, there's some... You reach certain limits where it tips over into where it's, as the surveyor said, we could repair it, but it would cost £1 million.
Very good example of how people can care for each other. And of course the central thing with boats is that you have to, because you can't leave boats alone, and so when you have anything to do with boats you are dependent on other people. You need other people to back you up the whole time, so it works like that.
When I was first here, because we were mostly quite young, it was quite, people had a lot of parties and we were very in and out of each other's boats a lot. And it was less structured than it is now. It was, the gangplanks were all higgledy-piggledy. You didn't have a sort of big, lovely pontoon in the middle. And you didn't have all these lovely lighting and everything. So it was very much more bohemian.
People would pop into each other's boats for tea. There'd be parties. So there was a real sense of family and community, which, again, is another appeal, really, to living on boats, is... You do get to know your neighbours very well, and there is a sort of sense of safety to that. And, you know, London is quite a hard place to live in, and so if you can move somewhere and have that community and get to know your neighbours, I think that's quite unusual.
We moved to Downing's Roads, and there was a community of us there that we just got on very well. We found out that most of us had actually been to art school or had been on a foundation course, so most people had a kind of creative background, and maybe that's what gave us some kind of common sharing of living in quite a different way.
Well, it's not so much anymore, but it used to be quite funny, because this particular stretch here on the moorings where we keep the shortest boats, it used to be Bachelor Bay. It was just filled with young, beautiful looking guys who were free, so nice to walk by since it's in the beginning of the moorings.
So our Christmases were spent generally all together. So sometimes there'd be 23, 30 of us, and we'd have one of the boats because we were all doing up the boats, and the Christmas dinner would be all day. So the potatoes might arrive and so might Christmas pudding, but the turkey would arrive afterwards because that wasn't cooked properly or whatever, but it didn't matter. And we'd play lots of charades and games and things, so it was huge fun. And we'd take dinghies out and we'd sing Christmas carols and go for walks and play things, so it was lots of fun.
Religious practices?
Yes.
Yes, there is. Every year, just before Christmas, we put our lights up, but we don't switch them on. And then we light a big fire up the top where you come in by the gate, and then we drink some hot alcohol and we sing pagan songs and we eat
babies.
Mince pies. Shaped like babies.
Everyone has got different skills. So if someone needs something, there's a lot of battering down here. They exchange services. Will you build my kitchen? Sure. Would you paint my bathroom? Of course. If you make me a cake for my mother's birthday, no problem. Will you look after my children? Yeah, if you cut my partner's hair. I mean, there's this endless trail of things that people exchange all the time.
It's a commons, you see. It has a common structure of governance. You can do anything as long as your neighbours are happy with it.
A bit like everyone lives on the river, it's a community. However, every boat is everybody's castle. So there can be sort of rifts and sort of differences.
So it was a very industrial scene here, and the Hollows footpath was just a sort of murky little track that ran along behind a high brick wall. And a few barges were moored here, and it was very primitive. We had an electric cable from the laundry that sort of snaked out over the wall, across the Hollows footpath, down onto the hard underneath, and up into the barge. And it surely was a floating fire trap. If you had a high tide, the boats could actually float onto the footpath because there was none of this sort of stuff. And it was not unknown, you know, to come back and find the boat partly on the path and having to lever this huge boat back into the water. But those things didn't seem to matter then.
The gasworks would seem to be contaminated land. There were a number of us squatting on there, some lovely boats squatting on there. West Country Ketch, a beautiful Dutch barge, this Edwardian yacht, a Humber keel, very nice boats and a fishing vessel. Slightly seen as a hippie community. Lots of issues with the council, and they got rid of us, evicted us. And so we squatted under Kew Bridge for about a year looking for alternative mooring, and then found a mooring at Chiswick, at Cornu Reach, where we moved. So at 4 or 5 years squatting before we found a permanent mooring.
There is a big issue in houseboat life, which you may come across elsewhere, as to who owns the mooring.
A houseboat is just a boat, unless it's got a place to be moored legally, in which case it becomes a home. And a home in London is worth a lot of money. Buy a rubbish old boat on a bloody good mooring and you've got an investment. Buy a very good boat on a rubbish mooring and you're losing your money. Easy as that.
If I have a hierarchy, then perhaps we're at the top of that hierarchy, which is it's a freehold plot of land with, in our case, associated with a house which we own, and the mooring is at the bottom of the garden.
People who are living here put together a bid and bought it from Chris Cruisers, bought a little tiny strip of land at the top and got a licence from the Port of London Authority in 1973 for it to be a residential marina, and that's when it all really started. But before we had all the piles and the pontoons, the boats were just all sort of tied together. They're all roped together and they were sort of joined by a couple of chains to the steps. One night it was very, very windy and the chains broke, and people woke up as the whole marina, all the boats, sort of crashed into the trees at the top of the island just a few metres away. And of course nobody knew what to do. But luckily, there was a chap here called Colin who has a lovely old boat called Astraeus with twin engines. And so he started up the engines and he drove the whole lot back over to where they were supposed to be, and they tied up again and all went back to bed and decided they'd sort it out in the morning.
That were actually moored alongside the wharf, because this had been a commercial wharf. So it was in the dying days of the working river. We were moored on this tidal mooring, so, you know, the tide would go out, we'd sit on the bottom half of the time and lean over slightly.
I was quite sort of fit in those days because I was used to carrying these tea chests of wood for the fire up and down the ladder. We were moored alongside the wall at the beginning, and you had to climb up this ladder. And it, when the tide was out, it was quite a long climb. So I was used to swinging down with the tea chest, and then I had to get used to swinging down with the carry cot.
But I was one of the founding members of the Chiswick Pier Trust, and that is immensely sort of proud of that model. And what we did was to create, it took us, I think, 10 years before we moved on lobbying in relation to moving that project forward, and moved on to the wharf, which had community facilities, but the bottom line is that it retained residential moorings. The negative side of that was that originally we were a community and we lived with no sort of standards or issues, and one of the things was that the community wanted, the new venture, wanted boats to be a certain standard. So when we moved onto the moorings and boats didn't comply to that standards, there was rifts in the community, and that's a negative in many ways. The community never, we lost some friendships in that, and life became a little bit tense.
So I managed to get hold of some Thames lighters, which are the kind of workhorses of the working river, attached those to the moorings, and then began to think of other possibilities. And even at that time, in the 80s, there were a few people interested in the idea of living on the river. And I think our first residential barge actually arrived, I know exactly when it arrived in 1985. So quite a long time ago.
We want people to be able to afford to stay on the river. We don't want this to become a marina where you have gleaming yachts and sort of gym palaces, as they're known in some circles. Well, A, it's quite rough here, actually. So they might scrape their wide, gleamy sides.
The big problem is that some of the pier owners, particularly, I mean, I'm thinking of Cadogan Pier and apparently now Cheyne Walk too, which is privately owned, are also doing the same thing. They're targeting people who have expensive motor yachts or a sort of floating pied à terre, and therefore people who are just living a normal houseboat life are being asked to pay more and more and more, and it's forcing people off the river.
I think the mooring owner has all the power, really. They have the power to put the price of the mooring up, and they have the power to boot you off. A couple of years ago, I did face that worst case scenario where the pier was bought and seven of us got 4 weeks' notice. I think it was quite clever what they did, actually. If I'd so instead of chucking everyone off, which is what they'll do eventually, they select every couple of years, they select a handful, which is enough to divide everyone. You know, if it was the whole pier, everyone would unite and protest, but because, you know, human beings are human beings, so those who are staying think, phew, glad that's not me, which, okay, not great, but that's human nature for you. Yeah, so the few get kicked off, and the few more the next year, and a few more the next year, and they get away with it. They will get away with it.
The politics of the river is very much, sadly, residents and users of the river opposed by the PLA.
I mean, naturally, their job is to try and strike a balance between all the various interests on the river, some of which inevitably conflict. So they have to decide, you know, what are their priorities, which is a tricky judgment.
They are a self-perpetuating oligarchy. They're not democratically elected and they can't be got rid of. And they are incredibly powerful.
They have an estate management attitude now, but unfortunately not a beneficial one, in that they're trying to jack up the rents to such an extent they're going to force communities off the river in favour of people who want an expensive yacht, effectively, or a second home.
London further downstream. It's a kind of canyon of speculative housing, and similarly upstream, up over here, and that seems to me to have changed the whole nature of whether it's houseboat living. It's changed the land side. It's also removed places, huge removal of places where boats could be worked on. I mean, the people that moved the Leonard Piper were saying it's really a problem because the housing, you know, boat yards become blocks of flats, yeah? And there's nowhere to tie up boats, there's nowhere to work on boats, etc., etc. Moorings disappear.
I would say in the time that I've been on the houseboats, the costs have doubled, particularly in terms of moorings, and being able to find a mooring is quite difficult. So when I started doing it, it was a cheap option, but I wouldn't say that's particularly true now.
And unfortunately, it's getting a little bit elitist too, because a lot of the moorings are being taken over by people who just want a status symbol boat, maybe for weekends. So it's suffering a bit like a pretty village from second ownership. I think that's a great shame, because then you don't get the communities.
More people are buying boats for investments now, but more people are buying everything for investments now.
That's the other side of what we've achieved here. You know, because we've got secure moorings now with planning permission and proper mooring agreements that are written and negotiated and agreed and everybody, those are worth enormously more, you know, than when we bought an empty box moored on a tidal mooring against a disused wharf with a vertical ladder and no services. You know, we've achieved something that is good, but on the other hand, we've pushed the prices up.
We've built some moorings down at Plantation Wharf in Battersea this last year, and you know, moorings are changing hands for £600,000. That's just a place to put your boat, not the boat. It's just a mooring. So the people who are going to live there aren't boat people, they are people with money.
The more you charge, the more you end up with sort of rich people playing at being river people. And rich people who love living on the river. I don't mean all rich people should be banned from the river. But it's a shame when there are all those modern designer yachty type things. But from my point of view, it's a shame when the old boats with personality and charm and battered up old boats that have had a lot of life are displaced by the modern cruisers, which are lived on occasionally. I think that's a shame.
If this was a marina that would take shiny yachts, the prices would go up, and of course we could do that. We could make this into a little luxury haven, but that would push the barge industry and this kind of river life away. And that's something that has to be protected.